Tonight we're beginning a four-part series, and of course we're going to try to do it in 4 weeks, but if it takes longer, we'll just have to do a part two of the four-part series. But I do want to entitle this series, Issues. Anybody have any? Yeah, we all have some issues, and tonight I want to focus in on the issue of frustration. I want us to look at a particular scripture that is familiar to all of us. It's found in Mark chapter 5. And I want us to begin to look at this by Mark chapter 5, verse 25. I want you to see this narrative, this story is found in several other places in the Bible, also in Matthew 9, 20 through 23, and Luke 8, 43 through 48. But we're going to look at Mark's account of it because it is more detailed and I believe most accurate. The Bible says that a certain woman, somebody say a certain woman. That's very important. I want you to keep that in mind. We're going to come back to that. She had an issue of blood 12 years and had suffered many things from many physicians. She spent all that she had and it did not get better, but she got worse. And when she heard that Jesus came and she heard that Jesus came in the press behind and touched his garment, or she heard when Jesus was coming by, she got in the press and came to touch his garment. And she said in herself, if I can touch but his clothes, I'll be made whole. Somebody say whole. Straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of the plague. Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? His disciples said unto him, you see the multitude thronging thee, and you say, who touched me? He looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace, and behold of thy plague. Amen. So tonight I wanted us to deal with just frustration. I believe that all of us understand what it means to be frustrated. Many people deal with frustration in different ways. Often there is a general way of camouflaging our frustration. But the truth is, frustration can impede your progress. In other words, you won't be able to focus or function because of frustrations. All of us are certainly used to various things kind of imposing themselves upon us all at the same time. Issues, just various issues coming at us all at one time, and nothing seems to get better. Let me look at this woman in the text. There's seven things that I want to share with you tonight that I believe she teaches us, that this text shares with us so we can understand how to deal with our issues. This woman who has an issue of blood, it literally becomes a prototype or an example of the various issues that you and I deal with on a daily basis. Now, let's understand what the Bible says, that a certain woman has an issue of blood. Now, we must understand, first of all, that she has a sad disease. Somebody say a sad disease. Now, why is it a sad disease? Because we must understand the background of this particular issue. The Bible says it is an issue of blood, or she is hemorrhaging. She is flowing in blood. And there are two things that make this particular disease of note for us. The first is the cultural implications of the disease. Let's understand that, because in order to really understand where this woman's frustration is coming from, you have to understand the cultural background of the disease. Now, when you read the Bible, the first five books of the Bible are called the Pentateuch, the Torah, or the law of Moses. And the Jews guided their lifestyle based on the law. The law of Moses. Now, in the law of Moses, the book of Leviticus, more specifically, we find what's called purity laws dealing with the body. A lot of stuff about piercing and tattoos and things of that nature you may find in Leviticus. But what's very interesting is that the Jews guided their purity laws, or guided how they understood the body, based on the law. Now, you have to understand that Jesus was a Jew. The culture in which he ministered was Jewish, and this woman was. And so when we go to Leviticus, let's get a backdrop of it. We begin to understand the cultural implications of what this woman went through. Leviticus chapter 15, and beginning at verse 19. Your Bible says this. Now watch this. This is what the law says. that if a woman has an issue and her issue is in the flesh, it be blood, she shall be put apart for 7 days. Whoever touches her is unclean until the evening. Verse 20 says, and everything that she touches, every single thing she lies upon in her separation shall be what? Unclean. Everything that she sits upon is what? Unclean. Whosoever touches her bed shall wash their clothes, bathe themselves in water, because they also are unclean. Now, what I want you to do is I want you, when you get home, to study to show yourself approved. I want you to continue to read through Leviticus in this particular chapter, because you're going to see now how a woman with an issue of blood was really viewed as a social outcast. Now, it's very important that you understand that her issue really hindered relationships. Nobody could be in relationship with her because they could not touch her. So now she's dealing with ostracism. She has a social stigma attached to her issue. In other words, people cannot touch her, and everything that she touches is called unclean. Now, what's interesting about this social stigma is notice what they call her, a certain woman. She does not have a name, but she is defined by her issue. This is what makes it very interesting when you have issues and you are frustrated, because people forget your name and they begin to define you by your issue. Who am I talking to tonight? And if you're not careful, that can be frustrating, because people will stop calling you what your mama named you, and they'll start saying you're the one that has this and you're the one that does that. And the truth is, it will cause social stigma. People don't want to be with you, don't know how to associate with you, and all of a sudden you find yourself walking alone. And not only was there cultural implications to it, but also watch the level of her frustration, because she has a continuous flow. The Bible says that it continues. It does not stop. In Leviticus, it says that when a woman's flow is after the normal process and she continues to flow, then she must be treated a certain way. What this symbolizes is that there's some issues that we have that just when I think it should be over, it seems like it's starting all over again. Just when I thought I made progress, it seems like I'm right back at the beginning. That can be frustrating. Just when I thought I was about to get deliverance, this thing jumped off all over again. Just look at somebody and tell them, now that can be frustrating. So understand now, let's get it. Let's put in perspective what we're dealing with. We have a woman with a sad disease. The Bible says she has an issue of blood. We know what happens with women with issues of blood according to Leviticus chapter 15. And then her issue is continuous. What issue do you have that is causing people to label you, that is causing people to distance themselves from you? And what issue do you have that you just can't seem to get rid of, that every time you try to get over it, it just keeps on coming back over and over again? Now, watch this. Not only is it a sad disease, but number two, she experiences a series of disappointments. Your Bible says that she had gone to many physicians and had suffered much by going to many physicians, and her situation got worse and worse and worse. Now, it's very interesting when you look at this, because when you have an issue, it's one thing to have an issue, but it's another thing to go to people who I think can help my issue, and my issue gets worse by going to them. The Bible said that she went to experts or expertise. The physicians, even though they were trained, this issue was beyond their expertise. One of the things you will discover in your life is that there will be issues we struggle with that are beyond human ability. That I don't care how deep you are, that can be frustrating when the very people you thought could help you can't do nothing for you. That's where somebody is right now. You're like, man, I went here, I went there, and I was certain that this thing was going to get better. But it seemed like the more folk I went to, the worse my situation got. And not only did she go to expertise, but I want you to see this. She paid a lot of money, which meant that her issue was expensive. Can I tell you something? Issues cost something. Somebody knows that issues can be expensive. How much have you paid for your issue? How much has your issue cost you? And the truth is, the Bible says she spent all her money. I want you to see her frustration. She spends all her money and she ain't got nothing to show for it. She's trying to spend all her money to deal with her issue and she ain't got nothing to show for it. And her expenses leads to her exhaustion, because the truth is she's tired. Can I tell you how tired she is? She's about as tired as somebody up in here. Can I break it down? Let me tell you how tired she is. The Bible said she had the disease for 12 years. Somebody say 12 years. Now, if the text had said 12 days, I would have had to minister to this sister. I would have said, wait a minute, don't you know they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength? What's wrong with you? Even if it was 12 weeks, I'd have been like, now be still and know that he is God. Even if it was 12 months, I'd have said, now listen, you need to understand that David waited patiently on the Lord and he inclined to him. But no, this was 12 years. You see, after 12 years, they that wait stop working. After 12 years, let's just keep it real. Be still and know that stop working. You tired of hearing about wait. Now, let's just keep it real. Has anybody ever got to the 12 year in your spirit? It may not be 12 years literally, but you at a point, you're like, wait a minute, if I hear one more sermon about waiting, if I hear one more thing about waiting, I'm going to lose my mind. It ought to happen by now. And so,
what do you do when you are totally exhausted? Well, you understand where you are. Bible says that it was 12 years. You got to understand how strategic this is. You know what the number 12 represents? It represents divine government or divine order. 12 disciples, 12 tribes of Israel. Jesus starts his ministry at age 12. What does this mean? It means divine order, which means at 12, that means that you got to put things in order in your life. I've come to tell somebody that maybe you're in the 12th year. Maybe not literally, but maybe in the spirit, that now God is saying it's time to start putting some things in order. It's time to stop running to people and let them frustrate you even more. But now something has got to happen in your life. You got to try something different. If you keep doing the same thing over and over again, you're going to get the same results. But now it's time to put things in order and watch God do something he ain't never done before in your life. Watch this. So she has a series of disappointments. A series of disappointments because she goes to expertise, it's expensive, and now she's exhausted. But wait a minute now. So what did she do? Your Bible says that she heard, someone said she heard, Jesus was coming by. That's very interesting now. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? So that she heard now, but faith needs a corresponding action, because faith without works is dead. So as she heard that Jesus was coming by, she realized that I must move from my position, and I must get where he is. Because just allowing him to pass by is not going to do it. I can stay where I am and let him pass by, or I can get in with him where he is when he passes by. In other words, what she realized is I must shorten the distance between me and Jesus. When you are frustrated, you're going to have to learn that maybe the reason why you're frustrated is because there's too much distance between you and your breakthrough. There comes a time when you got to realize that maybe I need to get a little closer. Maybe I got too much stuff between me and Jesus. And somebody here knows the closer you get to him, the better you're going to get. I believe I got two or three witnesses that can testify that every day you get closer to him, the better that thing gets. And if you ought to look at your life and say, now wait a minute, if I'm in the same place that I was last year, then maybe I need to check myself, because every day I ought to get closer than the day before. So watch this. So she gets closer. She gets closer. So when people come to you and they just say, I'm so frustrated, I can pull out my hair, say, then just say, then start stepping in the right direction. You stepping to me with it, I can't do nothing but make you more frustrated. Step in the right direction. Look at somebody and say, get a little closer. Watch this. So the Bible says she moves from where she is. This is very important now. She moves from where she is and she goes where Jesus is. She moves from where she is. Where is she? At a place of frustration. At a place where ain't nothing happening. But she is determined to get her breakthrough. So she moves where Jesus is. Now, she shortens the distance. How much distance is there between you and Jesus?
How many things frustrate you that cause you to think, maybe I need to get a little closer? Let me show you something. Well, when she shortens the distance. Now, we really have to appreciate this sister. We got to celebrate this sister. Can I tell you why? Because she survived the distractions. Now, what do you mean distractions, Pastor? Well, let me tell you. Now, what we have, again, is a multitude or a crowd following Jesus. Somebody say a crowd. Now, often crowds can be distracting. Crowds can be intimidating, particularly when you come from the backdrop of Leviticus 15. When everybody in the crowd knows the law, that you can't touch nobody and can't nobody touch you. So how in the world am I going to get to Jesus without touching folk? So imagine what she's got to overcome. But in order to really appreciate this, you have to begin to dissect the kind of people that follow Jesus. There are three realms of people who follow Jesus. Everywhere he goes. On the outer rim, you have the strict religious. The strict and religious people are the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They're Sadducee. And what they did is they always hung out on the periphery. They were always on the back, on the outskirts, and their sole motivation for following Jesus was to find out what he was up to and to report it to the council. It was very important. All they were doing was just eavesdropping. They wasn't going to raise their hand because they're too religious for that. They weren't about to cry Hosanna. They ain't going to do none of that, but they're going to show up every time Jesus is there, and they're going to sit there with their arms folded, and they can't wait the church over to get on the phone and report what happened. They can't tell you what the man talked about, but they can sure tell you who was sitting with who and who hair got done, and they can tell you who was by themselves, and they can tell you all the single men and all the single women that were there. I mean, they can tell you that, but they can't tell you nothing about what text it was. And if you're not careful, strictly and religious people will keep you from your blessing. Because it can be intimidating when you're dealing with religious people. This woman has to be, they know the law. So she's got to break through that crowd. Then there's another crowd she's got to get through. Once you break through the religious people, once you get through all them old stuck up folk, then you got to get through the shallow and rebellious crowd. That's the next dimension. We just trying to get closer. So now I done got past all the religious folk. Now I got to come to these old shallow rebel. Who are the shallow rebellious folk? That's most of the folk who are following Jesus to get some for nothing. Those are the folk that's just in the crowd just trying to get anything they can get without any accountability or responsibility. They just want Jesus to bless them so they can go home and keep on living like they're living. They want Jesus to bless them and without tithing, without doing that. Just give me whatever you got, Jesus, because I'm going to keep on doing what I do. If you're not careful, people like this will cause distractions and you'll miss your blessings. How many folk do you know who refuse to come to church today because they let the shallow and rebellious people keep them from their blessing? Now, let me tell you something that's so powerful about this. You have to understand that in the scriptures now, there's so many lessons to be learned. And one of the most valuable lessons you can learn here is that Jesus is in that crowd. I don't care what you say about it. You got to get in that crowd to get to Jesus. You better hear me now. This woman realizes if I'm going to get to, I'm going to have to get through this mess to get my miracle. Can I say it again? I'm going to have to get through the mess of other people to get my miracle. Look at your neighbor. Look him straight in the face and say, I love you. But your mess ain't going to stop my miracle. I believe I got a witness up in here today. I don't care what your show. I don't care what you did last night. I don't care what they're saying about you. Ain't nothing gonna stop your mess from me getting my miracle. Shallow and rebellious.
But then there's another crowd. Now here we pierced it. She's almost there. Somebody say, I'm almost there. I done got past the strict and religious and got past the shallow and rebellious folk. Now I got to get past those self-righteous folk. You know who the self-righteous folk are? Those were the disciples. The disciples who had missed the powerful lesson Jesus was trying to empower them. They hadn't learned it yet. It was too early on. So they had gotten so caught up with being with Jesus that they ended up sticking their chest out, walking close to him like they're the Secret Service, walking around missing the fact that they're supposed to be doing ministry. As a matter of fact, they're supposed to be watching and praying. You see, when Jesus had him in the garden, he said, could you watch with me 1 hour? And because they were so pious, they fell asleep. The truth is, you become so self-righteous, you don't even realize your spiritual responsibility. All you do is look down on other people and try to keep folk away from their blessing because you got it. You're so selfish and self-righteous that here is a woman in pain who comes to the crowd and Jesus' own disciples missed her on the radar. You would think that spiritual men around the Savior, if anybody ought to pick it up, it ought to be them. But because they're so self-righteous and so caught up in see me, they missed the need that was crawling up. But y'all better hear me up in here. You cannot let self-righteous people cause you to miss your blessing. You cannot let people who do not pick up your pain on the radar, because you got to understand there are going to be a lot of folks that will speak in tongue in church but won't speak to you in the parking lot. Self-righteous people are the kind of people that will come to church and sit right next to you and see you broken, see you cry, and won't even reach over and say, are you all right? Won't even pass you a tissue because they're so concerned about getting something for themselves that they'll let you come in and leave out broken without even ministering to you. Self-righteous self. But you know what? She survived it. I said, this woman survived it. I need you to see her now. Woo! She says, I'm going to get through this. I'm going to get through this. These strict religious folk. These shallow rebellious folk. And these self-righteous disciples. You know what it takes to get through that? Shrewd determination. Sometimes you can't be polite. Sometimes you got to want it so bad, you got to say, I don't even care. Y'all better hear me up in here. See, sometimes you got to want a breakthrough so bad. Sometimes you're so frustrated. You're like, I don't care what this look like. I don't care what you think about it. I am going to get this breakthrough by any means necessary. And this woman shows us some shrewd determination. Can I show you this? See, you got to understand something. I like this because it's interesting. It's clear to me that this woman coming to the crowd was a loner. Because the Bible didn't say she came with anybody else. This is sometimes what your issue will do. It will so isolate you. It will put you in a place that you begin to realize how powerful things happen in your life when you are alone. It is no secret that God dealt with Jacob when Jacob was alone. It is no secret that God called Moses on the backside when he was alone. Some of the most powerful things will ever happen in your life will happen when you are alone. Look at your neighbor and say, I may be alone, but I'm not lonely. I'm trying to help somebody up in here. And so when I'm alone, I know it ain't nothing but a setup because God's getting ready to do something awesome in my life. And sometimes God says, I got you alone because what you need, can't nobody else feel you. Don't nobody else have an idea. Here's the deal. She's got a crowd of folk around her, but nobody feel her. Say it again, a crowd of folk, but can't nobody feel her. That's the kind of lone that she was. She said, look, I got all these folk around me smiling in my face, but don't nobody know what I'm going through. And can't that be frustrating to have all these folk, hey, how you doing? But don't nobody really know what you're going through. You're going through something so private, so personal. You like, y'all don't even have a clue of what I'm dealing with. But you know what she teaches us? That when you find yourself alone, can I show you what you got to do? You got to get low. Look at your neighbor and say, get low.
Maybe you missed that. When you begin to study the history of this text, you begin to realize that this woman, how she got through the crowd, was not on her feet. She did not navigate herself like this. But in order to really get through the crowd, she got down on her knees and she scratched her way through. In other words, the lower she got, the closer she got. I think you missed that. I say the lower she got, the closer. I dare you to get on your knees and fall on your face and scratch your way and crawl your way and say, I'm so determined that I ain't after what everybody else after. So I don't care if I gotta get dirty, if I look differently, I'm after something called a breakthrough.
So listen, I'm almost through. And when she comes to the crowd, you gotta get this. I want you to understand something. I want you to understand it. Let's assume that we following Jesus this way. And all y'all following me, so we follow Jesus. And there was a woman coming from the rear. While we're following Jesus, she's coming crawling. She is so determined that whether we even acknowledge her, we got our back to her, but she's still coming. She said, I don't care if y'all don't speak to me. I don't even care if you don't acknowledge me. I'm coming. Excuse me, I'm coming. You don't have to call my, I'm coming. And that's the kind of determination that she has. And let me show you something. Somebody say, suddenly, this woman gets sudden deliverance. I'm gonna show you what sudden deliverance is. I'm gonna show you this. I want you to get it. The Bible says, get this now. She makes her way through the crowd. And the Bible says that when she gets there, the Bible says that she said within herself, if I can just touch his clothes, his garments. One gospel said if I could touch the hem. What's interesting is that all the writers of the gospels had different interpretations of what she touched. But the reality is that the revelation is wrapped up is not that what she touched, it's who she touched. As a matter of fact, he had so much power, she touched what was touching him. Can I tell you what a lot of your frustration is? You touching what ain't touching him. And if you can stop touching what ain't touching him and start touching what is touching him. And if two or three of you all touch and agree, y'all better hear me up in there asking anything. Something is bound to happen in your life. Here's the deal. She touched him. And by she said within herself, and this is powerful. Because this is faith. She believed that when I touch him, something's going to happen. Before she touched him, remember the corresponding action. She said, if I touch him, something's going to happen. Now, understand her faith. She says, if I believe, this ain't like the other times, that maybe if I go to this doctor, maybe it's going to work out. No, she said, this time, I know his record, that everything that touches him, changes. But now, let's again, because we're in Bible study, we're going to call this a theological framework. Somebody say a theological framework. That's a big word for, let's put what we're saying into a broader context so that we can clearly understand what's going on. Now, the theological framework or the context by which this must be placed is the word touch. Now go back to Leviticus 15. A woman who has an issue, if she touches anything, it becomes unclean. She said, if I can touch. Okay. Now here's the deal. When she touched him, he stopped and said, somebody touch me. The self-righteous disciples said, Master, a lot of people are thronging thee. Jesus said, but this touch took something out of me. This ain't no ordinary touch. This touch got a story behind it. this touch ain't like these folk just around, all these shallow folk. No, this touch got some pain behind.
Y'all better hit me up in here today. Look at your neighbor and say, my touch ain't like everybody else's touch.
Listen. There is some faith in this touch. Here it is. So when she touched him, Bible said, Jesus said, something came out of me. Now this is what you got to get. You got to get the deliverance. The Bible says, I want you to see deliverance. Back over in Mark 5. I want you to see it. Now, verse number 30. Jesus said, who touched me? Verse 31. They said, a lot of people touch you, Jesus. But look, if you will, at verse 28. Verse 28 says, she said, if I can but touch his clothes, I shall be made whole. When she touched him, straightway or instantly, her blood dried up. And she felt within her body she was healed of the plague. Somebody say, suddenly. When she touched him, she knew within herself then, before Jesus even said a word to her, she knew that something different had changed. That's the thing about a touch, that when you touch him, you know something suddenly happens. But you know, Jesus turns around. There's a marvelous paradox in this text. Paradox is a big word. It means something that looks like it contradicts itself but doesn't. Here it is. In Leviticus 15, whoever touches her becomes unclean. So we can understand maybe you touching the Pharisees, even touching the crowd, even touching the disciples, but I dare you bring your issue to Jesus. But you know what the paradox is about her touching Jesus? That Jesus says, you bring your issue. This ain't the first time I got dirty to make you clean. I took some mud one day and spit on it and made a mud pie and put on a man's eye and he got clean and healed. This ain't the first time, and it wasn't the last time either, because on Calvary he got real dirty just so you and I could be clean. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So I thank God that he was willing to get dirty so I could be. Watch this, and I'm through. Principle number 7 is that she has a secure destiny. Secure means safe. Destiny is the root word of destination. The way she ends up is secure. It is safe now. That her destiny now, her destination, she will not be defined by how we first met her. She will be defined by how we leave her after meeting Jesus. Here's the deal. Here's the deal. Let me show it to you. Now, in order to understand this, we have to go back to the text and look carefully. Watch this now. Let's examine it. Now, the Bible says that when she showed up, the Bible says in, I want you to get it now, verse 28, she said, if I may but touch his clothes, I shall be what? Underline whole. What is she after? Wholeness. But when she touched him in verse 29, she got healed. But now, you got to get some. Now, I want you to hold on to that principle, because I'm gonna leave you with this. When she touched him, she got healed. She was after wholeness. In verse 29, her issue, her flow stopped. But what affected her as a result of the flow, did not. My issue has stopped, but my pain has not. They threw beating me, but my pain ain't stopped. I'm healed, or I'm healed of the sickness, but what the sickness did to me emotionally is still there. So even though I'm healed, my head's still messed up. And so what's important to understand is that when we look at it, Jesus turned around in verse 32. And Jesus looked at the woman, but the woman feared. And the Bible says she knew what was done in herself. And she fell down. Somebody say fell down. Falling down means to worship. Whenever you worship, you are transparent. And she told him all the truth. When Jesus touched, she said, Jesus, I got to be real. It's been 12 years. I felt like giving up. I contemplated this. I ain't gonna lie, I said some things I shouldn't have said. I'm just gonna go on and lay it out there. I'm gonna tell you all of it. Because remember, this touch had a story. And Jesus wanted to know the story. You gotta be careful who you share your story with. Everybody can't handle your story. Everybody can't handle your tears. Everybody's not a shoulder for you to cry on. Some folk will take advantage of your vulnerability. You got to know who to go to when you open up your story. Who am I talking to in this place today? And she begins to tell a story. She told him everything about her pain, about the night she never slept. She told him how people treated her, how they made her feel. She told him how frustrated she was, how she almost gave up on religion, almost gave up on everything, even her own life, I'm sure. And the truth is, she told him the truth. And notice this. Let me show you her destiny, and I'm through. I won't even raise my voice for this. I'll let the scripture bless you. I want you to look, if you will, at verse 25 and read it with me together. 1, 2, ready, read. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years. Stop. Let's read that. Let's read the first four words of verse 25. And a certain woman. And we first meet her. She is defined by her issues and she does not have a name. After she touches Jesus in verse 34 and she tells him her story, he said unto her, daughter. I don't care what you call me. I don't care what you label me. After I meet Jesus, I thank God that he still calls me his child. I thank God he does not disown me, but he called her daughter. He still calls you son. Don't you get it by now that people try to put labels on you and name you by your issue, but you ought to thank God that you're still in the family. Look at somebody and tell him, I'm still in the family. Listen, I'm through. And he said to her, daughter, in a real sense, here's the translation of verse 34. Your touch heal you, but your faith made you whole. That here is your destiny. You may have other issues, but you ain't gonna have this one ever again. Somebody ought to give God glory right there. Somebody ought to bless him right there. Hallelujah.
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. Brotha Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.